Yes, thank you, Peter. Well, my talk is not about climate change in itself, but it's actually about the consequences of climate change, one of the consequences, and that is sea level rise and adaptations to sea level rise in the past. Because in the Northern Netherlands and in the Netherlands as a whole, we are dealing with relative sea level rise since the start of the Holocene. It's caused by melting of the ice sheets on Scandinavia, and that's why our country is subsiding. So my research area is in the Northern Netherlands, and that's known as the Turp region. This was a salt marsh region. All the greenish parts were salt marsh. You also find them in northwestern Germany and on the coast of Schleswig-Holstein and Denmark. And the people lived in these areas on artificial dwelling mounds. These are all the small dots, as you can hopefully see. Well, there are actually thousands of them in this coastal area. Now, there are many words for these artificial dwelling mounds in this area, but the word turp has become most used in international usage, so I will use that here as well. So I will concentrate on the Northern Netherlands because that's where my research is focusing on. And habitation in this area started around 650 BC. What was a turp? What did a turp look like? Well, this is an 18th century painting of the turp of Ezinge. Arrow indicates where it's found. Habitation started here at around 500 BC. And you see it's quite a nice shallow hill, and you wouldn't take it for an artificial dwelling mound at all because it's quite large. In the 19th century, it was discovered that these turps consist actually of very fertile soil, and that was the start of a large-scale destructive phase of commercial quarrying of the fertile turp soil, and it was shipped inland to as manure for poor, sandy and peaty soils. As a side effect, it became very quickly clear that these were not natural hills at all, of course, but these were totally human-made from the bottom to the top. Well, the quarrying resulted in many finds and also in excavations. And one of the most famous excavations in this area, conducted in the 1920s and 1930s, were the excavations in the turp of Ezinge carried out by our famous Professor van Giffen. And as you can see, there's excellent preservation of organic remains in the lower parts. These are from the Iron Age. We have a lot of well-preserved remains of houses, as you can see here. And we're looking here at the turp, a section through the turp. Well, this is actually, of course, wetland archaeology. These are wetland conditions, and that's why we have such excellent preservation. The turp of Ezinge looks like this nowadays, quite different from the nice hill that you saw on the painting. What we see here is a turp remainder. You see that in the center, where the arrows indicate the parts that are still standing. And there is a large leveled area to the right and the left. All the meadows were originally part of the turf, but these were levels. These leveled areas are called in turf archaeology turf soles. So these are the lower parts of turfs. You can still find remains of deeper features in this area. And what we also have is these escarpments that are the steep sides along the turp remainders, and these are excellent for very efficient excavations. And we have had a lot of them in the past decade or so. And I will show you one of them. This is an excavation carried out in the Turk of Anyum, 2006. Well, this is a very long escarpment, as you can see, and the Turk saw, and this escarpment was cleaned, resulting in this very nice Turk section of 120 meters long, which gives you, of course, a very nice insight in the structure of a Turk and its development. The results of commercial quarrying were not only negative. Of course, we have a large-scale destruction of the archaeological record, but also archaeological research in the Turk region started at the time. Quarrying resulted in many, many datable finds. They are now the collections of the museums in the Northern Netherlands, and these provide a very good overview of habitation history in this area. We also have an early introduction of ecological research. Already in the 1920s, archaeobotanical research started here, pioneers were working on it. Zoology, Van Giffen was a zoologist himself, and geology was also part of research. And excavators had an active interest in the rate of relative sea level rise. Well, that botanical research made it very clear that this was a salt marsh environment until medieval dike building, which started here in the 11th century. And geological research made it clear that sedimentation had continued while during habitation. So we find a lot of sediment layers against the outside of Turks. And that, of course, makes it clear that there were regular inundations during habitation. And to conclude, that's what they concluded already in the 1920s, Turks are a technology, a kind of technology that makes habitation in this rather extreme natural environment possible. Van Giffen had also an interest in relative sea level rise, and he calculated the rate of sea level rise by comparing the elevation of the Turk soils with sediments around the Turks. And this graph shows this rate of sedimentation for the Turk of Ezingen. You see levels of the level of the salt marsh under dated layers over time, between the 5th century BC on the left and the 12th century AD on the right. And he calculated that the rate of relative sea level rise was about 4 to 5 centimeters per century. Well, that was not quite correct, but not far off the truth, actually. Then after about 1940, nothing much happened in Turk archaeology until the 1990s, when a new interest started with the excavations in Wijnaldum. You may have heard of them. One of the focuses, not the only one, but one of the focuses is still on landscape, on the relation between human habitation and landscape, between culture and nature. Of course, the salt marsh is still renowned as a natural phenomenon. It's the most natural landscape we have in the Netherlands. But when you look at it closely, it becomes very clear that it has developed because of human intervention. And at the same time, human habitation in this area existed thanks to the natural environment. So we call this development, we like to call it the synanthropic salt marsh. So it's a close relation between the development of culture and nature in this area. This new focus is also, a geologist is always taking part in our excavations, and this has resulted in a series of paleogeographic maps which make the habitation history of this area insightful. I show you two of these maps, one from 500 BC, one from 80, 100, all the green areas are salt marshes and salt marsh ridges along the coast. These are the higher parts. And all the black dots are turf settlements from these different periods. Salt marsh expansion, you can see that at AD 100, the salt marsh region was had considerably increased compared to 500 BC. That is in this area due to relative sea level rise. And relative sea level rise in this area is about 5 to 10 centimeters per century. And in combination with, and that is very important, with a sufficient sediment supply. The expansion of the salt marsh region in this period, so between 500 BC and AD 100, was 5 to 10 meters per year. So that's certainly something that people were aware of. And what we also can see on this map is that there was considerable population growth. This was a very successful type of habitation. The first settlers came around 650 BC. They settled on the high salt marsh at the beginning, and they did not always apply hastening layers in this period, but that very soon changed. In the second phase, hastening layers were applied in the form of small platforms, and they also settled on the salt marsh ridges along the coast that had silted up to the level of only a middle marsh, which is flooded up to 50 days a year. These platforms are no more than 40 to 100 centimeters high, which must be the level of the highest extreme high water level they expected. And this apparently worked because we never find, or hardly ever find, sedimentation layers on top of platforms, or we do find them against the sides of these platforms. And that's also because the salt marsh area was quite fast. It had an enormous capacity for water storage, so flooding water could flow out over these large areas and did not rise to very high levels. Well, these first platforms grew together by intentional hastening layers and expanding extension layers. And on these, then sedimentation continued, water levels rose, and new platforms were made, and new houses were built, and this process was repeated again and again. And over time, about 2,000 turfs, at least 2,000 turfs, were built this way in this area, and we have very, very small house turfs and very large village turfs. Of course, these platforms, living on these platforms, must have been quite frightful events during storm surges, and there were requirements to these platforms, of course. They were not supposed to sag, the houses had to have a firm a foundation, and erosion was to be prevented. And that was done with very simple available materials in this area. In the first place, salt marsh turf, salt marsh salts, and animal dung, and sometimes wattle, but that was not used very often. Animal dung may seem a strange choice, but they had a lot of cattle and they had animal dung available, and animal dung also serves as floor insulation. We had some experiments with these materials. On the left you see a photo of the excavation in Ezinga. Below these are the structure, characteristic structure of salt marsh salts, and on top you see a dung layer, a dehydrated dung layer. And we had some experiments with platform building, you can see that's on the right picture. Some examples, this is from the excavation at Ezinga. A salt platform entirely made of salts from the 5th century BC. Then a platform made of an encasement of salt marsh salts filled in with dung and an extension stuff done on the site. And this was a structure that survived for a very long time. Also in the 8th century, in the lower picture, you see the same structure but filled in with sods. And this is a very nice one from Leeuwarden, various faces on top of each other, starting with a core of sods and then several dung layers on top of them. Now, my conclusions are that the Dutch are, of course, known as fighters against the sea, but in this phase, the first 1500 years of Terp habitation, they did not fight the sea, but they rather adapted to it. And they were profiting from sea level rise, of course, a moderate sea level rise. Terp habitation was a successful way of living there for over 1500 years. And not unimportantly, we think that this technology may still be useful now in low-lying coastal areas. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.